जय गिरिवरधारी, जय गिरिवरधारी,
Now, as we were discussing before, then the establishment of, or I say the reestablishment of our relationship with the Lord is going to be successful by associating with those who have such an interest, right? And then of those who are fully fixed in that, that's always the best, right? So now, that means then one has to have individuals who are present on the planet who then give this kind of direction association. So we have the community of devotees, and then there must be the leader of those community of devotees. Now, when you're in previous ages, then you're dealing with individuals who they themselves are interested in God consciousness. And because of this interest, they're going out of their way to find someone who can guide them in God consciousness. Like generally you see, if someone is going out and looking for a spiritual master. Although now and again you do see that Narad Muni just pops in on somebody. Right? Maharaj Prachinabhargi Shah was not actually looking for a spiritual guru. He already had his karmakanda gurus who were guiding him very nicely, right? But then Narad Muni came and explained to him that there's such a thing as spiritual, right? Because otherwise he only knew about the material, you know, the pious and how to be good and nice and do everything right. So then he, so you do have that happening in the other ages. But in general, people are going and looking for a spiritual master, understand the importance as part of the training, because they're following the Vedic culture. We have to remember, it's the other ages, they follow the Vedic culture. And the rest of the universe is following the Vedic culture. Basically speaking, this is the only place in the universe where there's an opportunity. If you don't want to follow it, you can. Right? We make it sound like, you know, what's it, 1960s, the Woodstock, we are the world, you know, kind of thing. It's not, well, no, we are a little small corner of the world. Right? There's so many unlimited planets, and on one of them, people don't follow Vedic culture. Right? So that's about how much, you know, we could say we are this world. You know, but we can't, you know, they're saying we are the world, meaning we're the whole thing, whereas we're what's happening, right? So, so in the Kali Yuga, then you have the need that since people aren't interested in God consciousness and aren't on their own going out looking for it, then there's the need to go out to them, right? And so because you're going out to them, you're going to be getting, and why aren't they coming looking? Because of lack of training, right? So then you're going to have some method, and then who's going out to them? Others who are basically from the same category, but have that faith and that sincerity that they want to develop. But it doesn't mean that they necessarily have the kind of the training and the maturity to make great decisions on the way of how things should be presented in Krishna consciousness. What is the essential points of Krishna consciousness? Does it make sense? Well, before they go out and find someone like Narad Muni, you don't have to worry. Right? So, in the Kali Yuga then, there's a system that's used by all the sampradayas, which has what's called the founder acharya. Right? The different lines call it differently, they have different Sanskrit names, I think. The Ramanuja line, they call it the Acharya Purush, like this. But Prabhupada used the term founder Acharya. So this is not like founder Acharya, meaning just he started something. Like sometimes we see devotees in their immaturity, they start something and say they're the founder of, you know, like that kind of, just like it's they don't understand the significance. It's more than the English word attributes to it. Right, so this is one of those words, because English, you know, we have to remember that English does not have a father. Right, it's one of those. It's not exactly an orphan. There is a mother, but there's no father. Right, you know. So that's the problem with it. So having that, it doesn't have the the development in all areas as it should. But that's not only just a problem with English, it's basically a problem with any language that's not connected to the Vedic culture, so basically other than Sanskrit, or what's called Prakrit, which are the direct derivatives of Sanskrit. So they have a wide range of words that actually have some meaning with God consciousness, right? It means English is very full in philosophical terms, but those terms are specifically meant for speculation. They're so that one can very nicely identify something, so it's very clear what you're speculating about, right? And that would be important, because otherwise how do you taste the variety of speculation unless it's exact, right? It means if everybody is writing a new thesis, then there has to be some exactness so that everybody can do something slightly different so it doesn't get too boring. Right? Otherwise the peers are going to die of boredom. Right? You know, so to avoid that, then there's quite exact words, you know. So, and those words we see generally go back to Latin. You know. So then there's some, so I think Latin has a father. Right? Yeah, so then they have something there. So whatever, you know, glory it gains is from there, but it's still going to be weak because it doesn't have terminologies to fit all the different aspects of the philosophy. Why? Because it's speculative. So something that's not so important becomes very important, and something that is important may get sidestepped, right? Just like one has ever looked at grammar, right? English grammar basically is after the fact, one's trying to put it together and make it work, right? So then the problem comes is that, you know, if you're going to deal with, you know, lower levels of grammar, you know, don't even bother to get proper definitions. You go to the university level grammar, and then you have the nice thing, and then each grammatical point will refer to something else, right? And then once you go around in the circle, you'll find you're right back where you were. So basically, it's by using it and by association, you gain the understanding of what it means, because there is no exact definition. I think a noun, person, place, or thing, you know, that's about it, and then the verb. But other than that, everything else is, you know, a modal. You know, it's all these different things that they don't have clear definitions. And how they categorize, how they relate, and all that, you understand? So that makes it difficult to then exactly define how an action is going on. What exactly is the relationship, right? Well, in Sanskrit, you have very, very clear definitions. It's very clear. You have six kinds of nouns that are primary, right? It's one with subject, your object, your instrument, your dative, your locative, and your accusative. Those directly connect with the verb. They're all directly connected. Then you have secondary nouns, right, which connect to the nouns and the verb, but indirectly. In other words, they connect to the nouns or they connect to the verb. You know, in English they call them pronouns and adverbs. And even that comes a little unclear, but Vedic is very exact. Right? Does that make sense? And then how the names of things, when you turn a verb into a noun into a verb, like this. So you have 24 parts of speech, and they're very exact. Each one can be defined on its own very clearly without, you know, the other ones there to kind of like give it. It's very scientific, right? So from that we see is then you can define very clearly an action, what is there. Just like the difference between the action that gets the goal and the action that gets things that help get the goal. You don't have definitions, like we were saying, Kretvarta and Purushartha. You don't have things like that in English. Does this make sense? So this is then where the difficulty comes up. This is why then a founder acharya is required, right? Because the founder acharya will establish how the philosophy will be presented so that particular time, place, and circumstance of those people, they will understand Krishna consciousness. Does this make sense? So we see that in the, that you have going back for the Nimbarkas, then you have Nimbarkas, you have Nimbarkacharya, that's pretty straightforward. So in the in the Kumara line, because you have four sampradayas from Brahma, Shiva, Kumaras, and Lakshmi. So then in the Brahma Sampradaya, then you have Madhvacharya, right? Then he establishes how things will be defined. The Shris, then that will be Ramanuja. The Nimbarkas, Kumaras, that will be Nimbarka. And for the Shiva line, that will be Vishnuswami. Right? Does that make sense? Mm. Then in the more contemporary time, then because Nimbarka and Vishnuswami go very far back. Nimbarka was actually on the juncture between Dwapara Yuga and Kali Yuga. He might have even been born in Dwapara Yuga. So it's right at that time. So it's you know, you're talking 5,000 years. Vishnuswami, I'm not exactly sure, but it may be like, you know, 3,000-4,000 years ago. So then we see as Madhva and Ramanuja will be more contemporary, you know, 700 years ago, and I think 1,200 years ago, like this. And so then you also have then Vallabhacharya, then we'll be speaking on that line in the Nimbarka line. So that he gives some more contemporary kind of direction like that. And we see even the Shankarites use this system. So you have Shankaracharya for the impersonalists. So it means that the founder-acharya, he's what you call, what we in our line call the Adiguru. Right? So that is the guru in which all other aspects of siksha instruction go back to. So here that Haridas Thakur explains the three levels of siksha guru. Right? You have what is called the Adiguru, which is the founder-acharya, in which all instructions must be in line with that person. Right? Then the next down that is what's called Sadguru, which is on the same level as the Diksha Guru, which means that guru which you have a specific personal relationship with eternally. And then down from that, the third level is called the preachers, right? The senior Vaishnavas and those who preach and who you get benefit and direction from, though you may or may not have a specific personal relationship with them. But the point is the instruction is valid. Does that make sense? Yes.
Where do the siksha gurus come from?
Those all three are siksha gurus.
Okay.
Right, so you have Adi Guru, Sadguru, and the preachers.
Okay.
Three kinds of siksha guru. Okay. Diksha guru is only in that category of Sadguru, on the second level. Right? So does that make sense? Yeah. So, because you don't have a variety of Diksha Gurus, there's only one Diksha Guru, though one may have unlimited Siksha Gurus. Right? Founder Char will be one, and then generally Siksha Gurus, that you, on the Sat Guru platform, there'll be a few that you see in that level, and then there may be so many other Vaishnavas you appreciate their direction and everything. Yes?
But should you have a personal relationship with the Diksha Guru?
The Diksha Guru you should,
yeah.
But it's not necessarily that they're always present. But some kind of personal aspect is there. In other words, the Diksha Guru has to be present when you connect yourself to the Sampradaya. You can't connect yourself to someone else. Otherwise, then, you know, we could connect yourself to Lord Brahma or Narad Muni or, hey, I like Vyasa. You know, he's a good scholar, you know, literary, you know, sort of thing. So it has to be someone who's actually living at the time, and you accept them, they accept you. Then if after that connection, you never see them again, it still functions because you're connected, right? Then it's carried on because having gained Diksha, then it's kept alive. The Diksha has meaning because of the Siksha, because of instruction. So that can be gained from that Diksha Guru, from the other Sadgurus like this, or from the preachers, any combination. But it all must be in support of what's given by the Founder-acharya. Right? Does that make sense? Like that. So we can see is the founder acharya is something very unique and very special. And they're the acharya for a certain length of time, for how long their line will last. Like today, if one's in the Madhva Sampradaya, then one has one's own guru who's present, who you take diksha from, you take instruction. But you see your guru and you see Madhva. What's in between you don't really worry about. Right, and then Madhva has his guru and like that. So that's where you start the parampara back. Between the founder and your guru, there's a proper connection, but that's not actually what you worry about because everybody in between is basically like a custodian who's seeing that the instructions are properly understood of the founder. Does that make sense? Yes.
So the eternal relationship, is that with the Adi Guru or is it with your
Diksha
Guru?
It's with both. And it's also with those siksha gurus that you may see on that level. Yeah, it means other Vaishnavas, the relationship's also eternal, but not in the position of guru. Does that make sense? They'll just be, you know, friends and this and that in the spiritual world. You know what I'm saying? But those who are guru, that will remain in that position, right? Even in the spiritual world. Though, depending upon where you are, it will remain more formal. Not in Vaikuntha Dwar, it will remain formal. But in Braj, then it's not so formal. You know, it's more a friendship, but it's a senior. There's still a senior. Does that make sense? Yeah. So then, So So what we're trying to clarify is exactly the importance of the position of the founder, Acharya. Right? So And then someone in the Ramanuja line, they have their guru who's they're initiated by. Then there's Ramanuja. So when they're speaking philosophy, it's only Ramanuja. Right? That's what they're speaking. But they've heard it from their guru. Right? Does that make sense? So their guru is to see that they're trained nicely in the founder's instruction. It's not a separate thing. Right? So the mission is the founder's mission. Right? And everybody's taking part and assisting in that. In other words, everyone is instruments in the process. So this makes sense.
So they don't make anything new.
That's the whole point. That's the whole point.
That line.
Yes. And the advantage is then someone who's giving instructions, they could be an Uttam, they could be a Madhyam, they can be a Kanista, it works. Well, if you don't have the founder Charya, then basically you want an Uttama. Otherwise, the process will be slow. But the point is even the person giving instructions, the neophyte, they're giving instructions of the founder Acharya, who is an Uttama. You understand? So that's why one sticks very nicely to this, that the instructions are coming from the Acharya. Does that make sense? And he represents the line before him. So whatever is before him, that's all taken and condensed and put here. While other ones, then before that, then they're just speaking at the time and it applies to their students. And it has that eternal aspect, but there may be the practical, specific thing applies just to their students. Right? But the founder then takes all that instruction and makes it practical for everyone who's going to be within the mission after that. So it's a very special position. It's not just arbitrary or anything like that. Does that make sense? Yes.
So will the language, the Sanskrit language structure still be applied in the same way in the nominative, operative?
Yes.
Yes,
that's always the same. So that means that they can then give it for however it will be applied. Right? Like you see Ramanuja, then he would preach in Sanskrit, but also in Tamil. You know, Madhva would use Sanskrit and then in his own local place, the Tulu or like that. So they'll have, but being Prakrits, then basically everything that, all the technical points, because in a Prakrit language, it's basically 90% Sanskrit. All that's been done is the grammar is simplified so that it's not so technical. You know, many endings are kind of dropped. It just makes it easier for us, just a spoken language. Because before it was, Sanskrit was the written language, and it was used in all official things. And the Prakrit was the local language that you used in the family and on the street. Though some places they use Sanskrit on the street also. There were places in India where Sanskrit was just the language. Does that make sense? Yeah. So, yeah. Yes?
Is Sanskrit the language that gives the spiritual realm? Just because, or is it totally different?
No, it's the same. But what will be used in the spiritual world will be the grammar coming from Narayana. In the material world, then you have 8 kinds of grammar. I mean, they're all compatible, but there are 8 kinds of grammar. So coming from Narayan, coming from Brahma, coming from Shiva, I think Indra, who else? Kavera, I think, you know, all the main demigods. They all have a different, like you notice in the verses, in the Bhagavatam, depending who's speaking, you see the verses are different. Like when Brahma speaks, there are always these 14-syllable verses. Right, so depending on, and sometimes they're very technical, sometimes they're more simple. Like that, depending on who's speaking, because the grammar is actually different. It means the main grammar is the same, but it's all the places that you have options on what you could do. Someone moves more technical options, someone this and that. So how you put it together, it comes out slightly different. Right? So in the spiritual world, they use the grammar of Narayana's. Right?
And Sanskrit is the language of the
spiritual world. Yes, yes. Vaikuntha, Dwarka, Mathura, like that. Braj don't know that, but they speak Braj Bhasa, which is a Prakrit.
And Bengali, is it also?
It's also a Prakrit, yes. That will also be spoken in the spiritual world. Uh-huh. You know, in the area, the Sweta Dweep is known as Navadweep. Lord Chaitanya has his pastimes.
To go back to the Adiguru, so our Adiguru is Prabhupada.
Yes.
And it's Prabhupada, not his guru, because Prabhupada established ISKCON.
Yes, well, it's not even so much about the ISKCON, because Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur gave the formula how the structure of the society works, because Rupa Goswami is the one who gave the mission, right? And he's the original, how you say, president of the Vishva Vaishnav Raja Sabha, right? That's what he established. Then the next was Jiva Goswami, then after that Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami. So our line of the acharyas that we have in the Bhagavad Gita, the gurus, those are all the presidents of the Vishva Vaishnav Raja Sabha. So they're great personalities, but the founder is one who then puts it together so it can always be used. People can say what they like, people jump up and down and this and that. But the point is if anybody's preaching in the West from the Gaudiya line, they are using Prabhupada's method. No ifs, no ands, no buts, no exceptions, nothing. Right? There is not one Bengali boy coming from his Bengali background, from his Bengali guru who came to the West and established God consciousness, the Gaudiya Vaishnava. They all came either on the tail of one of Prabhupada's disciples or using Prabhupada's method. And I'm just saying this because I heard this directly out of the mouth of one of the Gaudiya Acharyas. He made it very, very clear. Others, they like to say this and that and do so many things like that, but, you know, who cares? That's the bottom line. The point is that Prabhupada established how to take the Gaudiya mission around the world. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur wanted, Bhaktivinoda Thakur is the one who started it. Like that, because before Bhaktivinoda Thakur, you didn't have to preach in the Western environment. Because Vedic civilization was going on, you didn't have any other influence like that. Does that make sense? But with Bhaktivinoda Thakur, then the British had come in. And then the whole world had opened up to that. So now there was a need to preach in there because it was trying to influence the culture.
And then Prabhupada makes it palatable, acceptable, understandable to us.
And to everybody, Because otherwise it's just like this. Take Brahma Samhita. You've ever read it? Okay, every five words, you have to look in a dictionary. Like that. So that's the whole point. But Prabhupada's, even a very person doesn't know, it's just a common person can read Prabhupada's books and understand. And it's not that he simplified the philosophy. Many will try to say that. Unscrupulous people will try to say that. No, it's fully as technical as Jiva Goswami and the others. But he just puts it in simple language. That's why we're saying is that certain words have certain meanings. So founder acharya has a certain meaning. Right? It's not just because that's just the word in English. It has a specific meaning.
And Prabhupada's time, because you also say that the founder acharya has a certain time. Would that be like the 10,000 years?
That's the 10,000 years. Yes?
Could the founder be the, as in foundry, or steals?
That's generally how people try to take it. So then I think it's, you know, yeah, the founder of ISKCON and like this and that. But these kind of things it's improper etiquette. They don't understand what the term means. When you're dealing in the Gaudiya line, this means that person. You don't try to do that stuff. Because otherwise, like you see in the Ramanuja line, there's certain acharyas after Ramanuja, like the seventh from him, I think Bhadiraj. Seventh generation down. No, I think Vanyaraj is a little earlier. But whatever, they are very prominent in the line, but they only are speaking what Ramanuja. They just came to get some clarity because there have been some generations and things were becoming a little cloudy. So they come in and then establish, no, this is what Ramanuja is saying. Does that make sense? So once the founder Acharya is there, then no one's going to take a position, you know, separate from that. And if anybody does, then, you know, go look elsewhere. You know, it doesn't work like that. Yes?
With Krishna, yes. The Bhagavad Gita, would he be considered an Adi Guru, or is because his personality of Godhead, that's just...
Krishna is the original Adi Guru, so that's what the Adi Gurus are there. It's there, because he is Guru, Balaram's Guru, Radharani's Guru. So this is there. So Krishna is the original Guru, right? But there's Balaram and there's Radharani that's taking these particular aspects of the lineage. So in our line, then depending upon whether it's going in the friendship rasa or in the conjugal rasa.
So Krishna speaking about Madhira is...
He's always guru. So everybody's only representing him. So it's the same process that one's always representing Krishna. It's just that here one has to understand as if the founder made it in a certain way, it's meant to be in that way. And if someone thinks it should be changed, that means they don't understand either who they are or who the founder is. Like that. It's only due to immaturity that someone would do that. Because they don't know. Like the Ramanujas will never, it's sacrosanct. You don't do that. You're like this, but you know, we're Westerners, we don't care about any authority. Right? Our sentiment, our feelings are the authority, and for us that's all that's necessary. That's why we said we're Protestant by religion, Vaishnava by philosophy. Right? Like that, yes. Okay. So, yes.
You just mentioned that we also treat Srimati Radharani and Lord Balaram as guru. Can you explain a little bit more about it? Our Diksha Guru represents the principle of Lord Balarama Srimati Radharani, because I hear both. But
the whole point is by the grace of Nityananda Prabhu, you can get out of the material world. But the point is getting into the spiritual world, that's by Radharani's grace. So you need both aspects. Right? Does that make sense? So then, now we've established, how you say, the five of the schools of Vedanta, right? The four Vaishnava Sampradayas and Shankara, right? So the sixth school then is the Gaudiya line, right? So then the family acharya there is Srila Prabhupada. Right? Does that make sense? And so it's obvious by just how it works, how it's happening, right? Because we take it that, you know, so many devotees around and so many things happening is pretty standard. But this is, you're talking about taking individuals who are, you know, dead set on sending themselves to hell and getting them interested in God consciousness and going the other way. This is a very rare thing, right? The example is given, I think Lord Chaitanya to Sanatana Goswami, that on the bottom of the ocean, there is a turtle. It's sitting there. Right? Somewhere in the whole vast ocean. And somewhere on the surface of the water of the ocean, there's a piece of driftwood with a hole in it. The two are randomly on this ocean. Right? The turtle decides that now it's time to come up for air. When it comes up for air, its head pops through the hole in that piece of driftwood on the whole ocean. That's how rare it is to find a bona fide guru. So, that there's so many people in ISKCON, so many people connected, that's the power of the founder charter. Otherwise, it's something very, very rare. Because there's unlimited living entities. Right? There's, what, 7 billion humans. You got 7 billion ants in your house, right? You know? Right? And then there's the neighbor's house, right? And then there's the worms, and there's the bugs, and then there's the germs, right? You know, I'm sure there's way more than 7 billion germs in this room, right? You know? So the number of humans is so few compared to that. And that's just what's going on here. And this is just one small, we're a very small planet. Unlimited planets in the universe, right, through 14 planetary systems. So, the amount of individuals that actually have a chance to come in contact with the bona fide guru is very, very rare. Right? So the Prabhupada's made this very, very successful. You know, to the point where we think it's just pretty straightforward, pretty easy. You know, like that. You know what I'm saying? That's the power of the founder acharya. As one of the Gaudiya acharyas was pointing out, he was saying is that means anybody in the, you know, Gaudiya line that's bona fide, right? We're not talking about Appa Sampradayas. You know, we're talking about they're bona fide, like that. Then they are bringing actually the knowledge, you know, coming from the Parampara. So it's like, this, you know, you gave the example, like you have a stream, right? You know, like that. So depending upon the particular preacher, that stream may be of bigger or smaller size. It might be a small little trickle, it might be, you know, a bit of a creek, or it might be a small river, or like this. And so they were pointing out that we all, and we're talking about actually the senior most of those within the Gaudiya mission, right? That there hasn't been anyone that senior. And he's saying that we're like a small river, you know, or a rivulet like that. And he said Prabhupada is like the wide Ganges. Right? Ever see the Ganges when it comes down to the ocean? It's like, you know, it's I forget how, it's like a mile or more across. It's huge. He said, Prabhupada's like that. He says, that's the difference. He says, it's all we're all bona fide, because everybody's giving the philosophy coming in here, but Prabhupada, what he's doing, this is special. He's the one they call Prabhupada Shakyamuni Shabdata. Because the ability to take Krishna consciousness and that. So all we're doing is bringing out is that the glory of the founder Acharya, it's something special. It's not just he's a guru, right? And as time goes, then he'll kind of fade into the distance. Though the founder will always stay, and it's like we said, there'll be one's guru that connects one to Krishna, and the six gurus will have, and then there'll be Prabhupada, the founder Acharya. So even after 100 generations, there'll be one's guru and Prabhupada. So that will always remain. So if one's following then the Vedic, the Pancharatra tradition, then you'll always see on the altar the Pujari picture of his guru, and then there'll be Prabhupada and the four gurus before. Right? Because the guru and four before that, that's the Pancharatra system. You worship those five gurus. Like in the Yajna I think we discussed this, no? Yeah. So you have the guru, Parama guru, Parapara guru, Mahaguru, and Parameshti guru. That's the Pancharatra rule on these five are worshipped. Right? So then there'll be one's guru and Prabhupada and the four before. Does this make sense? Mm-hmm. So this is the specialness of the founder Acharya. So that means that what he's saying in the books is we have to try to understand that, and according to our realization of that, that's what we preach. And then as our realization matures and we see we understand more and more, we stick to that. We don't just keep saying, well, we said it before like this. No, we improve it, we develop it so that it's more and more representing what Prabhupada's saying. Does that make sense? So if you're speaking what he's saying, then you're connected. If you're not speaking what he says, you're not connected. It's that simple. Right? So, does that make sense? Just like it said, water that goes into the Ganga becomes Ganga, but water that leaves the Ganga is not Ganga anymore. You know, like in Mayapur, you have the Jalangi, it's coming down and it comes into the Ganga. But then after that point, it's just Ganges water. Right? But if there's any rivulet that goes out from the Ganga, that rivulet is not counted as Ganga anymore. It's just water. So that's the whole thing. If one's connected in that line with that founder, then the one has that same potency. One represents that potency. It means our ability to give it, we can give it on a small or a big. Because if one considers, much of the time, most devotees who have come in contact with Krishna consciousness and developed that faith and taken it up have done that by coming in contact with just general devotees, neophytes, even someone uninitiated. Because they're connected to the line, they have that faith in the line, they carry that potency.
Is it important to take initiation, to have diksha?
It's always considered a good thing because then it shows that one is serious about the process, about the bhajan kriya. But there's no time limit on it or anything. It's just something that happens naturally, like that. Does that make sense? But it's a natural process. So, you know. But at the same time, as accepting a diksha guru doesn't mean that one drops the siksha gurus. Sometimes the neophyte has an idea that, okay, I have so many siksha gurus, and then from amongst them one becomes prominent, so they become the diksha gurus, then I drop all those siksha gurus because I'm just being chased and this and that. No, it means chased is only one diksha guru, so if you don't go off having more diksha gurus. But there shouldn't be, but this siksha guru shouldn't be dropped. Because that's what all keeps everything working, is the instruction. So if you have the advantage to always be with the Diksha Guru and hear from them constantly, then great. But much of the time we don't, so then we hear from Siksha Gurus.
But it's a fantastic system, the whole...
It is a fantastic
system. I mean,
system.
The Parampara and the
yes.
Founder Acharya and...
Yes.
See how it works.
Yes, and it works
over
perfectly.
Time.
Yes.
It doesn't get diluted because you've got to keep on going back to that Adi Guru.
Yes, that's why it's done like that. Well, in the other ages, someone's only going to be doing that and it's going to be proper, so then it'll go down properly anyway because it's connection between us and, you know, means you have from Prabhupada and then a few gurus back to Lord Chaitanya, but then you see then a few back to Madhva and then Madhva to Vyasadeva, Vyasadeva to Narada, Narada to Brahma. So for us, I think there's only between Brahma and Prabhupada, there's only, I think Prabhupada's the 33rd in the line. For other lines, you see there's much more, there's 50, 60, 70, because the connections, you know, drop in many more places. But for us, then it's Brahma, Narada, then he speaks to Vyas, means this Vyas. Right? And then Madhvacharya had a connection with him. Like that, so then, you know, you cover 151 trillion years, you know, basically in just four generations. You know, so it goes pretty quick.
Who are the acharyas for Rudra and Kumara?
Kumara is Nimbarka and Rudra is Vishnuswami. Yes.
Siddha Maharaj before when it was not on a Diksha based, like before Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati.
It's always been Diksha. I mean, it's never Diksha based. There is Diksha. Siksha is the Vedic system. But in the Pancharatrik, there must be Diksha because of one's conditioning. You understand? Just like before, you go back into the Satyug, like in the first day of Brahma, early in that time, then in that Svetavara Kalpa, then you would find that there wasn't an institution as such of marriage necessarily. It wasn't necessary because the commitment between a man and woman would be so complete, there was no need to make it official. But then it was noted that because it wasn't official, that somebody might not maintain it. Does that make sense? Because so one day, the lady of the house was sitting there, and some Brahmin came along, just was coming down the road, saw her, and really liked her, and said, "Hey, come on, come with me." And she got up and walked off with him, and the children were sitting there, and says, "What's going on here?" Says, "You're our mom." You know, but there's no technically no rule, why not? So then that Brahmin cursed that women have to be connected with one man. So from that time, then the marriage ceremony is applied. Not that there wasn't always the marriage ceremony, it just didn't need to be applied in that particular short time. So there's a few things for a certain portion of Brahma's first day that don't need to be applied because generally people were so pure and everything, you didn't need so many rules. But, you know, necessary for the universe to run, those rules are established, but there's always some pastime that connects it. Does that make sense? So, the Siksha line, you accept, on the Bhagavat platform, you accept the instruction, then that is Diksha, right? That's how, because it said like the six Goswamis are direct disciples of Lord Chaitanya, right? But there's no Diksha ceremony. But what is there? There is the instruction that Lord Chaitanya gave them personally. You understand? You know, so Sanatana Goswamis and Rupa Goswamis, and you know those discussions are documented in Chaitanya Charitamrita. That's their initiation. Right? Does that make sense? So on the Bhagavat platform, then one doesn't require. But when one's conditioned, then it's required because otherwise one might not take it seriously. You know, this one's my guru, and then like this and that, and then you come back, and after a few weeks, a few months, then someone else is the guru. Said, "But I thought they were your guru." No, this one's the, you know, you understand. You're from which country?
Czech Republic.
Oh, okay.
Where does Vallabhacharya fit into this line?
Where does Vallabhacharya? He's in the, I think, in the Nimbarka line. He's just farther down the line. Yeah, he was a contemporary of Bodhicitta. So he introduced this parental rasa. Vrindavan, the parental rasa. Yes.
Might you have a question about how to perceive a position of a devotee, especially elevated devotee? Sometimes we hear discussion that the devotee reenacts the lila, but it's it's not really doesn't have the human experience because it's like guided by Krishna. And there's another commentary where people say if you accept that opinion that the devotee it's sent by Krishna and is sort of understands the mission, then you remove the human experience of a devotee. You know what I mean?
But or a chinta beta beta tata, why can't they both be going on? Because if Krishna didn't send, then who did it?
I don't know, I asked the same question to myself. I don't know why.
You understand? The point is there's both there. Is Krishna God or not?
Yes.
But does Mother Yashoda look at it that way?
No.
So that's the thing, they can both be there at once. That's the whole point, is that, because the one brings out that appreciation and all that, and because, see, is that you can't have relationship or rasa unless there's appreciation. If you appreciate the person's qualities, then you can have a relationship. You don't appreciate, you can't, right? So the tattva establishes that appreciation. Having been established, now the other aspects of rasa can take place. So the two are very compatible, but the tendency is that we always try to look at things black and white because that's how the material world works. It's called the realm of duality, or the place of names. So we love to give a name to something and call it new. It's a shoebox. No, it's a footwear holding bay or something. And ooh, that's something new.
iBox.
An iBox, yeah. It's a high tech footwear box. Yeah, so so both are correct, but it depends upon which aspect you're looking at, you use one or the other. And they can both function simultaneously. This idea it has to be one or has to be the other, that's mundane. But the two can go on at once, that's the spiritual. And it's just which one will be going on, or which one you'll be noticing, because they're both functioning. Right? Just like Prabhupada said, all his disciples were sent by Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakura. Did that take away from his interacting with them as disciples? Yeah, you understand? So that's the whole thing, is that both these have to be there at once. So that's why there's not a problem. We don't have problems. There is no such thing as contradiction in the scriptures. They're just pointing out different aspects. Yes.
It seems to me that the best way to appreciate Srila Prabhupada as a founder acharya and such a great devotee is to read his books and to study his books.
Yes.
And I always get maybe discouraged when I see how sometimes devotees just don't have a taste, or they say they take it very cheap, like the books, or I'm too busy. So from your perspective, can you share how to inspire your friends or devotees to read books in the best way?
The process that we follow is the process of self-realization. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So the point is you can perfect your life on your own. Not meaning without the process, but means you can go back to Godhead even if nobody else does. Mm-hmm. Right? That's one of the instructions and the final instructions of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati. He was making the point, don't be discouraged that not many people are interested in pure devotional service. He says, don't worry about that. You worry, you yourself can practice it and go back to Godhead. You understand? Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur said, Srila Prabhupada said, if one devotee becomes perfect and goes back to Godhead, the whole mission, all their whole endeavor will be worth it. Right? Because the devotees are so dear to Krishna that if in your preaching you can get one person to go back to Godhead, that's enough. Right? And so you can understand Prabhupada's vision. So many here. You understand? Does that make sense? Okay? So, having said that, therefore, you be inspired to read the books, whether anybody else cares or not. And if you're inspired to read the books, what inspires you about the books, you'll be able to inspire others who are inspirable. But if you become discouraged, then that means them and you are not reading the books.
Does it mean we have to be a little bit detached from the result of our preaching?
Yes.
Or a lot.
Who's the preaching for? Yeah, so it's not for us. It's not that I said it, it has to happen. You know, we're not talking Ramses here, you know, let it be written, let it be done. You know, we're talking, you know. No? Sorry.
Maharaj, when you were talking about teaching, Prabhupada's teachings, it reminded me of what you were saying on Sunday about primary versus secondary.
Yes.
And obviously we have so many mediums of delivering Prabhupada's
yes.
teachings. So good, due to good association, I guess the challenge is not about forgetting the ultimate goal, but to me it's always about wavering and focusing on the secondary
yes.
as opposed to the primary.
Right, right, right.
So how to be able to create that balance where we are always focusing on the primary and the secondary is just supporting that ultimate goal.
Okay. Okay. Do you understand cooking?
Yes.
Okay. Now, is there a goal to the cooking? What's the goal?
It's the experience and developing the relationship.
Okay.
Due to the activity, which is eating.
Okay, so how will that be enhanced?
Well, with the...
You know, it means, in other words, would you consider it a part of a success in the goal of after the meal, everyone goes, wow, well, that was filling.
It's a sign. It's a sign that it's a...
You don't host much.
Not a lot of things.
In other words, should it be nice? Should it be a good experience for them? Was it tasty? Was it, you know, well arranged? Did everything match? You know, it's not like we had, salad and salsa or something. You know what I'm saying? Guacamole and lasagna. Yeah, okay. You understand? So, you're trying to make a meal that matches whatever is that particular situation you're functioning in, right? Okay? So now, you're going to use cooking technique and ingredients and pots and pans and all that and the various ways of applying that to the fire, right? Okay, so now in doing that, do you forget what you're cooking for or who you're cooking for?
No.
So that's how the two match.
Okay.
You understand? So if you actually understand the primary, then while you're performing the secondary, it's always being performed in a way that it gets the primary. Otherwise, how do you know what's the point of what you're doing?
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know, if I'm in the kitchen and I've got my drill and I'm, you know, putting shells up, you know, like that, great. But am I getting dinner ready? You understand? So that's the thing, is if you know, then you know who you're cooking for. You know, and what's the occasion and everything like that. So that's the whole point. So whatever you do, you know what it's for, where it's going, because you know what the goal is. So the main point is being aware that there is such a thing as that goal, and all these others are goals getting there. Because sometimes by dealing with the secondary so long, we forget. Let's say someone's like a full-time cook in the kitchen, and they're doing the same thing every day, day in, day out. They may forget that they're cooking for Krishna, or cooking, you know, the devotees are satisfied, or, you know, that there's different programs. There's the daily programs, there's the weekend, there's the big festivals. So they don't apply themselves, and what they're trying to do, they're trying to see that Krishna and the Vaishnavas are satisfied. You understand? So they may forget because they just get caught up in that. So that you have to worry about. So that's why one always has to see, this is the primary, and then this is... Then whatever you do will always be at your best. You understand? So that's the whole point, is if one follows this process, one actually does better. It means the spiritual works better, the material works better. So what we're talking about makes both better. But from the material point of view, is what we're saying by this point of duality, it's either the spiritual or the material. I can't do both. I can't be, you know, a devotee and be all spiritual all the time and, you know, take care of the family. What does that mean? You know, Yudhishthira could do it, Arjuna did it.
Kunti
did it. You know, so that's the whole point. That's what Bhagavatam's teaching is how to do that. How to, in everything that you're doing, connect it to Krishna and make it perfect. But that means you always have to see the primary. Right? So Narad Muni's going through all the different rules of family life in the Bhagavatam we see in the morning. But he's always bringing what aspect of connected to Krishna is it doing? What's it for? What's its purpose? Because otherwise, we sometimes just think the ritual has to be done because it should be done, or if we do it, there'll be auspiciousness, or, you know, some profit, or, you know, and things will go nicely and smoothly, like that. But the point is, no, it's to please Krishna. Because if we're pleasing Krishna, automatically the other's already taken care of. Right? If I'm trying my best to cook to please Krishna, automatically it will taste as good as I can cook. You don't have to cook for Krishna and try to make it taste good. Right? We try to make it taste good for Krishna, and then it's automatically. Does that make sense? Yes, that's the point. It's dynamic. It's dynamic. You know what I'm saying? Just like yoga. Okay? When you first start, you become aware that there's this thing called breathing. Right? And that it somehow or another is connected and synchronized with the particular asanas and what you're doing and all those things like that, right? Now, let us say, go down the line 50 years, someone who's, you know, very advanced in yoga and all that, do they worry about the breathing? Are they able to connect the breathing properly to the asanas and everything? So, that's the whole point. It doesn't stop. Even on a daily basis, you don't breathe, you die. Right? You know, so you can't say, well, you know, is anybody saying, well, breathing's so archaic? You know, the young people these days at the college and university, they're all saying, oh, breathing, oh, that's so old-fashioned, you know, you still doing that? You know? And sex, my God, even the protozoa did that. I mean, wow, we don't get involved in that. But eating, oh, come on. You understand? So that's the whole thing, is that it all goes on. That's the whole thing, is that's what makes the human element, is that we're always involved. That's the point. So the central point is not the knowledge and not the goal, but it's the activity. Because it's through the activity that we get the goal. So that's where we're going to be situated. But the point of the activities to get is Krishna's pleasure. Does that make sense? So that's why of our deities, Govinda is actually the prominent deity. Gopinath is the Lord of Prayojana. But it's actually Govinda, through the process of devotional service, how will please Gopinath. So therefore, the pastimes are the most most prominent. Does that make sense? So that daily interaction with the devotees and the deities and all these things, that's there. And with time, it becomes easy. You know, I mean, in the beginning, to get the practice and then relax the muscles and then not fall out of position and then, you know, not bother the person next to you and, you know, not burp, you know, all these different things like that. And did I wear the right stuff and, you know, like that and, you know, all these things. But after a while, it just becomes natural. So it's not that one's not aware, it just becomes very easy. Is that something?
It's like always remember, never forget.
Yes, that's all. So it's just as you do it more, it becomes easier. But it's not that it won't be done. This idea, I did it and then I can sit back, that's actually, you know, an impersonal concept. Right? Because I've done it and then the result lasts eternally, the Brahmananda. But the point is karma, you always have to be doing it. Like that. So this is activity on the spiritual platform, so it's eternal. Yes.
Maharaj, would it be true to say then that most rituals are something that is imposed as an authoritarian thing rather than something that is in a sense, come from a groundswell of feeling. You know, because you're talking about marriage as a separate, as a ritual, it's because it's setting rules about what needs to be done,
okay.
Rather than it being an expression of the feeling. Of
no, it's both. It's to ensure that the expression is there.
Yes.
Right? In other words, you have a family unit. Why will it stay as a family unit? Because there's a marriage. Right? So in other words, if people are on the platform where they don't require that rules, but then it leaves out some of what Varro was talking about, the human element. So you're talking about in the very beginning creation that there's living entities that are so pure and so close to that Brahman level of realization that all these things don't mean much to them and don't matter much.
Right.
But as it starts to drop down in consciousness, if there's not some regulation, there's bound to do something wrong.
Right, so the regulation is, and so then your need for the regulation in that is dependent on your consciousness.
Yes.
Okay,
right.
So then one can say that, you know, like you said, the initiation is a reflection of one's need for that sort of event.
Yes.
To have the samskara in your
life.
What you will continue. But if you don't require that or you don't need that, then that's another form of initiation.
Yes, but generally what that's taken, if you're on the Uttam platform, in other words, if you're liberated, then you don't require the rituals.
Yeah.
The rituals are to engage our conditioning so that we progress, like that. So that's all. But it doesn't mean that in the application of this ritual, that there's the part what's called Vaidhi, which just means you're following because you should.
Yeah.
And then there's what's called Raganuga, which means you're following out of spontaneity.
Right.
Does that make sense? Just like, let us say, you have an Olympic coach, right?
Mm-hmm.
So every gold medalist has a coach. The coach, most of the time, can't do what the gold medalist can. Occasionally, they were previous themselves gold medalists.
Mm-hmm.
But much of the time, they're just people who know the science that's required to do what they wanted, they need to do, and they know how to teach it to you so that you can learn it. And then according to your ability, you go out and win the Olympics, right? So he knows the rules in that. So for him, that's Vaidhi.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if the person he's teaching, it remains as Vaidhi, he doesn't win anything.
Yeah. Yeah.
But when he comes to the point where it's spontaneous, you can do it all naturally, that's when things start to happen, right? But the advantage is that For going to Vaikuntha, those in that line, the Vaidhi works all the way through because they're going to do Vaidhi in the spiritual world, so they don't have a problem. In our line, then even if one doesn't generate or come to the platform of the spontaneous in this lifetime, it doesn't matter because when you go back to the spiritual world, you'll take it up from there, like that. Because, in other words, on the platform of Bhava will happen. It's called spontaneous devotional service. Right, it's naturally there. But one could be practicing that here also. It just depends upon when it matures. So for us, it's not a problem. Even if someone's following Vaidhi their whole life, we don't have a problem with that. Because it will turn into the other later. But if it turns in now, it just makes it that much easier later. That's all. Point is it all has to be done. So if you do it now or do it later, it will get done. Like that. Is that
yes.
So then, just a moment. Okay. So then the founder Acharya, then he establishes how, you know, like for us, you know, what's important, what kind of program we follow, what are the aspects that we do, you know, how we approach the literatures, everything like that, based on all the instructions given by the previous Acharyas. But now the depth of their instruction we can only understand through our acharyas. So that means if we have our guru, we can understand what's before from that. Now when you have the founder, then you understand all the previous through the founder. So by our guru, we understand the founder, by the founder, we understand everyone before. Right? But the center point is the founder here. Right? So then the Rupa Goswami gives that as I think it's the fifth point of the 64 items of devotional service, the Nectar of Devotion, sixth chapter, that following the footsteps of the previous Acharya through one's own So we don't approach directly. So if we find there's a difference how Prabhupada presents something and let's say Jiva Goswami presents something, if we see a difference, we take Prabhupada's approach, and by approaching Jiva Goswami in that angle, we'll actually understand what Jiva Goswami was saying. And then we'll, you know, with time we'll see that they are not saying something different. So that's the thing, there's never any contradiction in Shastra, never contradiction in the Acharya. Sometimes it's brought out. I saw something the other day. They're trying to make this whole thing about a problem between Ramanuja and Madhva. That's only between the followers. The neophytes have these problems. They see differences, but they don't have any problem. They're all part of the Lord's plan. So that's one of the qualities of Narad Muni, is his ability to reconcile all these different seeming contradictions that are there in the scriptures. Right, because the scriptures are talking that are applied to everybody, that means the application of a particular rule may be different for the different individuals that it's applied to. Or it may be different according to the circumstance. Is that what he says? So the rules have to be explained in such a way that they can accommodate all that. So many of them see this contradiction. But actually there isn't. It's just depending upon what's the application. Okay, so the founder then works so much of that out that you'll see it, and knows what you can present nicely, what you can't present nicely. So someone may bring out something very strongly because of the need, because of a particular group of individuals at the time, but then after that you don't really need to deal with that. So then what is necessary, so the difference between, let's say, what Jiva Goswami was saying, that's the universal aspect, and then what aspects he was specifically talking to the audience that he was talking to, then Prabhupada, you know, will let us make it very clear for us, like that. So we don't have to speculate, because otherwise some say, well, Jiva Goswami, he preached Swakya. He didn't preach Swakya. It's just he had disciples who couldn't digest Parakya. So then, instead of explaining it through the point of rasa, he explained it through tattva. Right? Because in tattva, there's Krishna as the Purusha and Radharani is the Srup Shakti. So they're eternally married. Right? And so on that plan. But just for pastime, it appears as if it's Parakya. You know, you understand? So for people who can't digest, they're just so fixed and it's got to be this way in a religious thing, they can't accept that. You know, does that make sense? So then you explain it this way by tattva. But it's thought, no, he's explaining, like Prabhupada's explaining in rasa, that he's also explaining rasa. He's not. He's explaining in tattva. So there's no contradiction. Yes?
Is there a particular way to approach the books of Goswami that Srila Prabhupada didn't comment on after reading Prabhupada's books, of course?
Which books didn't? What do you mean didn't comment on?
Some of the Rupa Goswami and Jiva Goswami books that, for example, he, of course, wrote Nectar of Devotion, right? I mean, summarized for us,
right,
to understand. And that's one of the books that we read first. But there are some of the very advanced esoteric books of Goswami's that generally love.
Wait. When you present these things, you shouldn't be contradictory. Means the whole process is for what? What is the problem? Means we're sitting here for what? Why are we sitting here? Just, it's a great place to sit. You know, we like the marble floor. You know, where else in the city do you get a marble floor? You can just sit down on it. You go into the, you know, okay, the high court has marble floors, but can you just sit down on the floor and do some yoga? No, you can't. But here you can, so that's why we're sitting here.
Chanting Krishna
Prema. Okay, and how you get, and how is that Krishna Prema expressed? Do we just sit there and meditate? It's all telepathy, you know, it's a 1960s thing.
Hearing and chanting, serving the devotees.
And then what is that called? There's a name for that kind of activity.
Sadhana bhakti.
Just sadhana bhakti, or what would be a generic term? Bhakti. Okay. So if you have the science of the ocean of devotional service. Okay? How would you say that that's the basic literature, and then there's esoteric?
What I meant is just sometimes...
Yeah, that's, you have to, when you're talking about the acharyas, you have to be very more exact.
Just, feeling that sometimes I'm afraid to start those books because they're very elevated, and I'm thinking,
no, but what are those books and what is this elevated?
Like Lalita Madhava, you know, Rupa Goswami, or maybe Gopala Champu.
But they're just expressions of what is going on, the dramatic expression of what goes on in Nectar Devotion. So you understand, have you read the last chapters of, like, from the second, third, and fourth sections of the ocean? And so do you appreciate the difference between
yes.
Stai-bhav, Vibhav, Anubhav, Sanchari-bhav, and you appreciate that. So all you do is apply that into Vinakramadava. Right? But how do you understand Nectar Devotion? That's how Prabhupada came. So there's nothing that Prabhupada hasn't commented. There's books that he's directly commented on, but there's no new information. Right? There's unlimited variety of how it's applied, but there's not something new. You understand? Because of the material, we take it that whatever we're doing, it gets old, we have to do something new. But on the spiritual platform, you can do that forever. Mother Jashoda cooks lunch for Krishna eternally, and she never thinks, you know, okay, come on, can I get a break here? You know, like that, you know, she wants to go to, what is it, Abhita or something like that, you know, for a little bit of a break, you know, come on, you know. You know, can't someone else cook lunch? Hey, this is Braj, there's plenty of people here, you know, come on. You know, Mother Jashoda wants some serious me time. You understand? You have to remember, she wasn't born between, what is it, was it 47 to 63, you know, it's called the me generation, so she wasn't born then, so she doesn't have these problems. Yeah? Okay? So, therefore, it's a matter of understanding how the system works. It's the same thing, it's just presented through different mediums. Right? The science of how the pastimes work is given in Nectar Devotion. With that science, then you look at the pastimes. Okay? Right? In the Nectar Devotion, and the science that he's going to say, the feminine nature, you know, the inherent feminine nature, because he defines all the different aspects of Radharani's personality, right? He defines Krishna's personality, I think there's 96 aspects, and then Radharani, which is like 200 and some odd aspects. Okay? So, then, because there's formulas of that. You have certain things, and that's multiplied by something like this. Okay? Yes? So, then, sometimes you explain it so much you forget what you were talking about. Well, I guess maybe that's for tomorrow. Okay? So we'll leave that. Okay? Yeah. So the point is that you have to, what the acharyas give, you have to take that, and it's science. And so, oh, that's what we were saying. And so he's saying the generic feminine nature is contrariness, elusiveness, and shyness. Yes? No? I'm not asking for your approval. I'm just telling you what Rupa Goswami says. He would know. Okay? In other words, we're trying to move on to thought here. Okay? So, understanding that now in Vidagdha Madhava, do we see examples of contrariness, shyness, or elusiveness? So then, you're just seeing what Rupa Goswami has already defined in Nectar Devotion. That's why you read Vidagdha Madhava, like Lalita Madhava. If it's just, you know, it's, you know, you could be reading that or reading Shakespeare, then, you know, it's nice, better than reading Shakespeare, but the point is you're not getting the full benefit that you could get. It doesn't mean it's not to be read, it just means that's what, in other words, when you can see Nectar Devotion in Vidagdha Madhava, then that means now you're reading Vidagdha Madhava. Otherwise, you're only reading Vidagdha Madhava. Right? You understand?
Yeah.
So there's a difference. Yes?
Once I'm, excuse me, you were giving an interesting analogy. I will always remember that, like reading elevated scriptures and not understanding them is like sitting in front of a feast and appreciating the size and shapes and colors, but not able to eat it.
Yes.
Not being able to eat it.
Yeah, no, that's good. Kind
of, really understand the technical side of it, how it looks and the steam or whatever.
Yes. Very steamy. Very saucy. Yeah, that's true. Very good. Does that make sense? Because otherwise, we're catching something, but you have to understand is that the more we read it, the deeper it'll get. Because it's like, I think it was, I don't remember what the literature, one of the acharyas had written a book and gave that to one of the other Goswamis to read. And he became so absorbed in the mood of the book, I think it was Separation, that he was lamenting so much, and it was such nectar of the book that he was reading again and again, and so absorbed in this, they were worried that it was going to be bad for him, because he was so absorbed in lamentation and everything. So that same acharya wrote another book that was, you know, one of happiness and, you know, all kinds of fun pastimes, you know, just to get him out of that mood. So, you know, so many months later, he put that book together and then he gave him that, and then he read that, and then everything balanced again. You know what I'm saying? So that's what you can get from the books. We just go and read them. Well, nice, you know, and that's it. So, good, it's connected to Krishna, but we have to understand is when we say it's more elevated, that means because there's more things to appreciate there. You know? If the ABCs, you know, Bhagavad Gita, every time you read it there's something new, then why wouldn't there be on that level? The difference is in here you'll see the tattva and all that, but on there you see the rasa. Is that okay? Yes.
Another comment here might be to that all the Acharya writings are Bhagavatam commentaries.
Mm. Yeah, very good.
So when you read Bhagavatam, if you know Rupa's frameworks and his explanations, and you actually get to read Bhagavatam, as you're suggesting, in relation to Vishnu and Yamani and so on. Mm.
Yes.
That's how it goes to structure.
Yeah, it's just, that's all, because all these things, everything is a commentary on Bhagavatam. Nectar devotion is the Abhideya aspect of it. The Sambandha aspect, that's Brihad Bhagavatam. Right? And then the other acharyas have written commentaries on nectar devotion, Madhurya Kadambini, you know, all these different, like this. Does that make sense? And so then those, like that. And so what Prabhupada's giving his books, it already contains all that, because he has the commentary.
So it's nice if you read them in conjunction.
You can. It's there. But the main thing is if you understand what Prabhupada's saying, then what the acharyas say will make some sense. Otherwise, I've seen devotees read what the acharyas say and then say, well, you know, Vishwanath says this and Baladev says that, and they contradict each other. And it's kind of like, why would anyone even put that in writing? That's like, you know, mm-hmm. Narad Muni's famous for being able to remove those. So why would one... you know, how you say, write down this lack of understanding and put it out for common devotees. You know what I'm saying? Why would you do that? You know, it's just like, generally you don't make it public that I'm an idiot, right? You know, you don't do that. You know, but it means, of course, you know, the ladies in the house want you to make sure that you've said it clearly and you understand it, but it's not necessarily meant to be public unless they feel it should be. Right? You know, so like this. So what I'm saying is you wouldn't do that. So if you see contradiction, that means you shouldn't be reading it. If you see that it's all homogenous, then you're safe reading it. But as soon as if you're reading, you see that, well, this one's saying this, that one's saying that, how does this all work out, then put the book down. Right, so step away from the book. Yes.
So basically, reading books above sort of our grade could lead to committing offenses.
Can if you don't, because otherwise you think this is that, and so many things. You either speculate or you see contradiction between each other. A lot of times you say, well, Prabhupada's saying this, Jiva Goswami's saying that. There's this whole big kerfuffle about it when it's not. They don't say anything different. It's just that they don't understand what they're talking about. The point is depending upon the individuals that they're discussing, depending upon the approach, then it's described there. You know, so then it's just like this. If I say something that connects with the mundane intelligence, my question's answered. If I say something that's actually spiritual, you require spiritual intelligence to understand it, and I don't have it, it doesn't matter how much I explain it, no one's going to have it. Does that make sense? So, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, when asked, where does the jiva fall from? He says, Brahman. And then, because we said Brahman, and we can relate to Brahman from our conditioning of jnana, then we just go, oh, and no one asked another question. Ramanuja does the same thing, Madhva does that. They just do, it's just one of those topics they don't want people to discuss. So they say these simple answers, because the point, it's not that it's wrong. It's fully correct, because the living entity is tathasta. Where's tathasta? It's in between spiritual and material. What's in between spiritual and material? Brahman. So we fall from the platform of being tathasta Brahman into being in the material world, instead of going from tathasta Brahman up to spiritual. Right? And every time the living entities come out, when the Lord breathes, then everybody's in Vasudeva Sattva. They're all in Brahman realization. Every last living entity. Right? And then when the secondary creation happens in Brahma, then they go back into, according to their desires, back into the particular bodies according to what is their previous karma, and then take that up. So again, they fell for Brahman. You understand? So, explain, but just that you said it from the mundane side, we'll look at it and go, oh. And it's not even understood actually on the spiritual side. You know, but it keeps people from talking about something that's weird. You know, it's just like how you say, the kids, you know, whatever it is, you know, he's playing and his ball goes under the bed and he goes and digs under the, you know, his, whatever, his somebody in the house's bed, and he comes out with some girly magazine, okay, and then he asks his wife, what's this? What's she going to say? She's going to go into a whole explanation or just say something simple that the kid understands and takes away the magazine and the kid forgets about it. Mm. That's sort of so that's the whole point, is if you see contradiction between the acharyas, don't read them. Because if you think there's contradiction and this one, this, and that one, that, it will be detrimental. So that's the whole point, is that the founder acharya sets the mood, establishes it, and so then if one follows that, everything will be perfect. And then one expands from there, because he has said what books from which acharyas to read, and like this. And then that gives a further detail, but you understand that further detail in connection with the fundaments the prophet's given. Because in the spiritual, fundaments are up. In the material, the fundaments are down. And then we speculate and build on top. But there, the fundaments are up that don't change. Then we use the intelligence and expand it down. Does that make sense? So that's what the glory of is the fundaments are the highest. And then certain detail is given, you know, for the particular, and then if you can appreciate in connection with that, then great. And if not, we just see it's but it keeps us busy. It's 9 o'clock. And here. What? Oh, just wait for it comes out. Okay. So any other? Yes.
Can you just clarify for me, please, the Sadguru?
Sadguru means eternal, means that who you have a relationship with eternally in the position of guru disciple. Okay? Srila Prabhupada ki?
Jai!
Srila Prabhupada ki?
Jai! Srila Prabhupada ki? Jai! Srila Prabhupada ki? Jai!